Hello, everyone. Like Alan said, my name is Hanson-Ahumada with the Endangered Species Coalition. Super excited to help moderate this conversation today. Before we get started, I want to do some thank yous to all the people that helped put this together. So first off, I want to say thank you to my amazing partners in creating this event. So I'm going to embarrass you and make you raise your hand. So Rosie, Sanchez with WildEarth Guardians. Chris Talbot-Heindel with Rocky Mountain Wild. Elena and the Patagonia team. Our amazing DJ, DJ Mantra in the back there. And then our food, and there may still be some more, so make sure you get some while we're talking, was provided by Maria's Empanadas. Beer was from Mockery Brewery. And kombucha was from Third Bird. So feel free to go get more food and drinks while we're talking today. It's a very relaxed situation. Okay. And then another thing I want to share real quick. So some of y'all may have seen the animation that was playing here earlier while you're sitting. I just want to share a little bit about that. So that was an animation created by two ecological animators named Ed Carr and Gabriel Rowland. So they created this animation to celebrate the wolf and the wolf reintroduction. So feel free to come back to the DSC booth later if you want to learn more about the animation or the artist. But this animation, as well as this event, is part of a larger celebration for the wolf that we're calling like Denver's Wolf Celebration. So there's other events happening in June here in the Rhino. There's a mural dedication ceremony happening on June 18th. So there's some murals going on and being put up in the Rhino District, so check those out. And there's also a local band called Lost Walks that's playing, performing a band and dancing, and the theme is on the Wolf Reintroduction, so that's on the 24th. So more information about that can be found at the ESC booth, so other events to check out during the month. And with that, I'm gonna pass it over to Rosie for a panel introduction. Panelist introduction.
Hi, y'all. Once again, I'm Rosie Sanchez, she, her, AF pronouns. And I'm with WildEarth Guardians once again. I'll thank all of these people up here in just a moment. But first, I wanted to start with the land acknowledgement. And I know that these might seem common these days, but really taking the time to slow down and acknowledging the land that we are is really important. So acknowledging indigenous, and I'm a millennial, so I write everything on my phone. Take it or leave it. acknowledging indigenous peoples as the original caretakers of these lands and waters is a first step in reconciling historical injustices, supporting current indigenous sovereignty, and uplifting indigenous knowledge systems. The lands, waters, and air are eternal. For millennia, they have nurtured the growing bodies of our planet and animal relatives. They have given us shelter and warmth. They have provided us with food and fresh waters. Every piece of land you step on in Colorado has been known, stewarded, and named by indigenous peoples. With that, I live and work on the lands of the Cheyenne, Arapaho, and peoples, further acknowledging that there are 48 contemporary tribal nations that are tied to the lands that make up the state of Colorado. All right, so conversations around wolves can be a little polarizing. To ensure we're respectful of one another's time, I would like to instill some community agreements with everyone that I'm hoping that we can all abide by. So be curious, open, and respectful. No one knows everything. Together, we know a lot more. If you need to take time for yourself, there's beer, kombucha, and food, and Maria's influence. One mic, one voice at a time. Once again, wolves can be heated conversation. Let's just respect one another. Take space and make space. There are no dumb questions. And if you do have questions, please let them be known so you can be as present as possible. But I'm having a hard time thermoregulating right now. It's very hot. So if you see me glistening, please excuse me. With that aside, I'd like to make a couple of introductions. First, once again, Chris with Rocky Mountain Wild. They're an amazing partner and co-host for our Wolf panel tonight. Rocky Mountain Wild is truly an amazing organization with their Bat Watch and their PICA project. They do amazing community science work. So if you haven't had the opportunity to look at her table, please stop by. All right, now to these two. It's truly my honor to be up here with some amazing people today. First, Dillon, I'm so proud of him. He has been from ESC for how long now?
Since August,
so very new to the game, but has made a significant impact with marrying art and activism. Very proud of him. Yes? All right, now for our panelists. John puts down his head. So I'd like to introduce John Murtaugh with Defenders of Wildlife. I've gotten the pleasure to work with John at Defenders, and he is truly a force in the wolf world. John works to create a strong coalition of support to ensure that wolves and people can coexist in Colorado, and he's an all-around amazing human being. That's it. I'm doing this to embarrass him at all times. Karin Vardaman is the founder of Working Circle. Working Circle works directly with ranch families to help them implement strategies to reduce conflict between wolves and livestock. The return of wolves to their native lands does not have to preclude viable working ranches on those same lands. Karin and John actually met and worked together for the first time at the Colorado Wolf Center, right? California Wolf Center. Great. So thank the both of you for being here. It was more like a demand for John, but thank you both for being here. And I will pass it over to Dillon.
Check. Awesome. So we're going to start with some questions for the panelists. So how this is going to go is Rosie and I will ask some leading questions to get us talking about wolves here in Colorado for our panelists. So feel free to listen and hear what they have to say. But I also have some pens and paper here. Should have passed these out beforehand. But maybe I will give them to y'all to pass around. So during the discussion, if you have any questions about wolves, feel free to write them down. And at the end, we're going to have a Q&A with the audience. So you'll be able to ask your questions to our panelists and get those answered. So you can either keep them in your brain or write them down. We'll pass around those papers and pens. So with that, I'll start off with our first question. So this is for both of you all, so whoever wants to go first. But could you tell us about your story of self? Tell us about yourself, and what was your aha moment with wolves?
She wants to be a cop, right? I'll take the mic. I was going to try to just speak loudly, but we're not even.
All right, there we go.
All right. Well, thank you all for coming. My story. What is my story? Well, I guess actually started off with the dog, as it often does. Growing up, I had a mixed shepherd, husky, Rottweiler butt of a dog who I had just convinced myself was perfect. She wasn't. But I convinced myself that was true. I was young, a young man, 6, 7 years old. And that was right around the time that they were getting ready to be introduced to Yellowstone. So where's the receiving source? Right? That, no.
Just hold it really close to your mouth.
All right, so I'll let Karin take that because I can do the booming voice. So I fell in love with wolves because of this dog that I thought was a wolf. I learned about the Yellowstone reintroduction around that same time. Actually, at Applebee's was a placemat that Defenders of Wildlife had sponsored that told the story of the wolf reintroduction. I was hooked at that point. I love wolves. I wanted to figure out how I could do more, how I could get more involved. But I had older brothers. And older brothers, they love to kind of cut you at the knees sometimes. So they convinced me that there's no way to make a living trying to save a wild animal. So I went to film school. I don't know why I thought that was a way to make a living. I pretty quickly found out it wasn't going to work. I spent some time in Belize, wildlife rehabilitation, eventually made my way to California, to California Wolf Center, where I met Karin doing the awesome work she was doing in Northern California to help some of the wolves that were starting to come back into the state to really make sure that we were addressing the conflicts or potential conflicts that could happen. And I think that's when our story came together. That's a pretty good segue.
Okay.
There, can you hear me okay? Okay, I'll try to hold it close enough. So my story is actually sillier than his, because my background is in marine biology. I grew up in Southern California, so beach girl, rode horses, and became a biologist, worked with the oceans 24 years, great retirement plan, I was gonna be there forever. Never really thought about bull. Actually, I did. I used to have 9 years as a kid of bull chasing because of all the fairy tales, right? And one day I was looking for a new screensaver for my computer, and I was looking at whales and dolphins. And I came across Defenders of Wildlife, had all these cool animal screensavers, and all of a sudden this wolf image, just a very common wolf image out there, pops up. And I know it sounds really silly, but there was something about the way that wolf was looking at me, those eyes, and I became obsessed. I chose that screensaver. My colleagues were like, why do you have a wolf on your screen? The ocean is too. Like, I don't know. I started reading about them. Then my hubby took me to a surprise birthday present tour at the California Wolf Center. All I saw was a nose and a tail. I signed up that day to volunteer. I drove 2 hours one way. So 4 hours round trip twice a week to volunteer, to every possible class that possibly could. 2 years later, they got a grant for a half-time fundraiser. Gave up my whole career for half the salary to do this thing. And then a year later, I was promoted to the Director of California Wolf Recovery, where wolves were coming in. I was on the stakeholder working group. That was a huge eye-opener. and they also was involved with Mexican wolves, spent some time down there in the Southwest as well. The rest kind of history with obviously being on the stakeholder working group, being introduced to the grant inside, changed my world forever. 12 years ago.
So thank you so much, Karin and John, to make me use this microphone. So we'd love to know more about your work pertaining to wolves in particular in Colorado. This is me asking you to brag a little bit about yourselves too, relationships created. What draws you to this work in this state?
Well, I mean, right, but I am of course exceeding. So Colorado. So I came to Colorado. We're going to reintroduce wolves, an opportunity to do something that no state had done before, and obviously really exciting. So my work, I'd say, really throughout 2019 was, like a lot of people in this room actually were intimately involved in this. We were all campaigning. We were gathering signatures to get this question on the ballot. We're out there getting the vote out to make sure we had a successful vote. Then November came, we squeaked out a win, a lot closer than anybody anticipated, but that told us we had a lot of work to do. And so since then, a lot of that work has really been focused on a couple of processes. One, the stakeholder advisory group, which is Colorado's kind of internal body, discussed some of the social implications of reintroduction. The technical work group, which, as you can imagine, is the technical aspect of a reintroduction. And of course, the Parks and Wildlife Commission. The Parks and Wildlife Commission, at the end of this stakeholder process, they're going to create recommendations for Colorado Parks and Wildlife. Colorado Parks and Wildlife will take those recommendations and create a draft wolf management plan. But that plan will need to be confirmed by the commission. So that's where the focus is going to be once we have that draft. So if we have comments, something we like or don't like, that's where that next kind of stage is going to be at that Colorado Parks and Wildlife Commission. Everything else in the meantime, because the pandemic had us so locked down, was really trying to work through Karin. And I'll let her speak, you know, those experiences, but a lot of really great work that we've been really focused on in the wild, on the landscape where wolves may one day. And without giving Karin's own story away, you know, it's about meeting people where they're at, trying to have healthy understandings of each other's values. So we can find a place where wolves, people, and our livestock can share them. So that's kind of in a nutshell, but Karin will hit those points nicely, too.
I don't know about that, but gosh, so Colorado. Well, so obviously, you know, my early work began in California, and I'm not pretending to be an expert in anything. All I can do is share experiences through those experiences, but we found some really amazing, really successful started to come in to the state fair on its own. And one thing that I recognized when I was on the stakeholder working group it kind of hit me. I'm like, here we are. Then I think it was only 20 years after the reintroduction of Yellowstone, but you know, here we are all these years later. And it didn't seem like we were any closer to creating that lasting environment for wolves, livestock, and people. Like, it was the same conversation that I had read about, heard about, and, you know, kept thinking that there's got to be something here that we're missing, or there's got to be a way we can kind of dig deeper to get rid of it, which is what led me to, you know, reach out to ranching. And through those experiences, I realized that, you know, the stories I had often heard as the rancher being kind of set up as the villain in the story didn't line up with the experiences I was having on the ground. And the more I learned and the more I felt like my veil of understanding had been lifted, it seemed like the pieces of the puzzle started together. And regardless of how people might feel about, you know, grazing and that part of it, in order for this to work for wolves, it has to work for the people that are actually working the land, living with them. And there are ways that happen, and that through experiences in Montana, through working with these folks, realize that there is a positive way forward where it doesn't have to be one or the other. I mean, wolves don't have to exist at the expense of ranching, and ranching doesn't have to exist at the expense of wolves. There is a third alternative, and that's what we try to focus on, kind of that win-win scenario. So through those successes there, if you think about Siskiyou County and the two packs they have and the challenges they've had, you don't hear all the hype and, you know, disastrous things because they have figured out how to make it work. I happened to move here to Colorado just kind of coincidentally at the same time this all started. So I was on some of those early fox myself, and actually John and I together started going out to North Park 2015. Because if you look at historically where wolves came in, I was always of the we're going to get here one way or another, regardless of if it's a reintroduction or if they're coming on their own, they're coming. And that's what we need to focus on. So we built some early relationships out there. And so when the wolves did show up, it was fairly easy to step in and build upon those relationships with the ranchers. I'm actually pretty much living full time up in North Park now with a field trailer. And as John said, it comes down to those relationships. And they're working with folks to A, make them either feel supported. We're not going to get rid of conflict. There's going to be conflict. It's not going to ever completely go away. But how do you create an environment either ranchers can withstand the conflict, you know how to handle conflict or reduce it enough that is doesn't impact so much? I mean, as we know, you know, it doesn't affect the livestock community, I mean, as a whole, the industry, individual ranchers, and quite different. So we're making some huge leaps and bounds. I know the media, right, keeps focusing on, you know, the negatives out there, but that's only part of the story. You know, we're working with a bunch of ranchers up there that are having no issues. And, you know, I think that was some of the early work that we've tried to do up there.
Great, and I'm gonna take one step back, and this isn't a question or a question cheat sheet here. Could one of y'all just briefly talk about what the reintroduction is, what Proposition 114 is? I know we have some folks from, you know, not from Colorado, so just, you know, high level, what is going on with this reintroduction?
You want me to be succinct?
Yeah.
Well, boy, okay. All right, so Prop 114 was an initiative in 2020 that basically stated that it charged the Colorado Parks and Wildlife Commission with creating and approving a plan to reintroduce gray wolves by December 31st, 2023. So that basically is our deadline. I will quickly mention there's a little disagreement about interpretation here. I would certainly say our interpretation in drafting and promoting this was to say paws on the ground by December 31st, 2023. Other interpretations might say you just need to have a plan. We are certainly all going ahead, full steam ahead with the December reintroduction. That is the plan that we're working on. So basically, plants don't pop up out of the ground, and when they're such a controversial species like wolves, you really want to make sure you're hearing from everybody. So Colorado Parks and Wildlife hired a third-party facilitator called the Keystone Policy Center. They've worked with the state on a number of different issues, and excellent hundred, right, Keystone? So they are the facilitators for this process. This process is wrapping up, though. The technical work group has already completed their final report. The stakeholder work group will end in August. So it's getting real close. The next meeting, though, for the stakeholder advisory group will be here in Denver.
There's a call to action.
Okay.
We'll talk more about that.
That's the process right now. That's going to end, and then they're going to basically, as I mentioned earlier, go through a draft process. There should be another public comment tour with that draft process. So that'll be our opportunity as the public to kind of weigh in and say, you know, what we like, what we don't like. But that's the plan. There was one little hiccup, though, in all of this, and that was on February 10th.
This one of our questions.
This is one of our questions.
I just get ahead of myself.
The next question, then. In February of this year, a federal court, district court, struck down the 2020 decision by the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service that removed federal protections from gray wolves, which means that they were off the species list across much of the U.S. We won't get into those eight populations. Anyways, what does a federal relisting of wolves mean for Colorado wolves and the process for reintroduction?
It meant a complicated process got a little more complicated. So when Prop 114 passed, the gray wolf did not have federal protection. It had state protection, fully endangered in the state of Colorado. There was no federal involvement, which meant effectively Colorado Parks and Wildlife could run the show. As of February 10th, with wolves now getting their federal status restored, that means authority returns to the federal government, specifically U.S. Fish and Wildlife Services. So now Colorado Parks and Wildlife has to enter into discussions and agreements with the federal governments on how this process is going to look like. What's most important, and without getting into too deep into details here, there's something called a 10J process that they're going to look at. What a 10J process effectively does is it allows for management of an endangered species as if that species were listed as threatened. So it does mean generally a weaker level of protection. What that means practically, in the case of wolves, is it means that under some circumstances, this would allow Wildlife Services, U.S. Fish and Wildlife Services, and or Colorado Parks and Wildlife to legally remove the wolf. This is the process that every wolf reintroduction has gone under in this country. So this is always how they have done it. I think we could probably hem and haw about the pros and cons of this process, but I will say that is the process they're going with. Just this last month, they hired their drafter, the company that's going to draft the 10J for them. That plan is expected to be concluded, get this, December 15th, 2023. And you might remember we're supposed to release December 31st, 2024 by then. So it gives us a 2-week window here. So we're cutting it close, but that's currently how that process is played.
Great. Next question is for you, Karin. So talking about coexistence, so could you explain what coexistence means, including some successes, examples, as well as tools for coexistence?
Certainly. So it's interesting that word coexistence. Because when people think, oh, you coexist, that's great. But there can be successful coexistence and not successful coexistence. So what we're trying to work towards is obviously successful coexistence. These wolves are going to share the landscape with, you know, the ranching community. And what we want is the ability for ranchers to be able to, you know, ranch with minimal conflict, or to be in a position if they have conflict, it isn't, you know, the end of the world. Doesn't have the dramatic impact. We want wolves to be able to thrive on those landscapes, okay? That they can successfully share the landscape and successfully coexist together and thrive. At least that's how I, you know, describe coexistence. Not just the minimum getting by, survive, being successful, right? Not feel either worried about wolves, you know, being killed, or ranchers constantly having to focus on conflict. And the way that we go about it is a little different than maybe it's always historically been done. You know, we've learned a lot since the Yellowstone. I mean, coexistence strategies have come a long, long way from a lot of the basic tools, Flattery, hot wire, or fox lice, which are good. I mean, they help. They're good supplemental tools. Oh, flag, good idea. Good thing. You know, wolves are interesting critters. Unlike mythology, they can be pretty skittish about new things. So they're very neophobic. So flattery is an interesting, or just like a string, and usually it's a hot wire, not too far off the ground. Little red flags and just pictures of them. And when they kind of flap, it's something feeling different. The wolves are like, what is that? And they stay away. And it's interesting because the fact that they respond to that is what makes coexistence with wolves a lot easier than coyotes, mountain lion, or bear. Because wolves have this sense of self-preservation, and they're always playing risk against vulnerability. Or the risk to my safety, I'm going to get clobbered by antlers or hooves, you know, to get this kill. So that works to our advantage. But the tools now, at least that we'll be focused on, are kind of twofold. One, taking it to, you know, when we're talking to ranchers, if they are just focusing on the conflict, on the tools, on the wolves, that's taking a lot of valuable resources away from them. And it also creates a barrier for them to want to try, because they're already working hard and struggling, most of them, trying to get by. So what we do is we take a look at this comprehensively as what are the ranch goals, and then figure out where the risks are at the individual ranches, whether it's the train or cattle are handled, and then simplifying all this, of course. And we look to strategies that fit into their plan so that it doesn't take away resources. Because historically, coexistence has taken tremendous amount of time, energy, emotions, to have it not necessarily be very sustainable. And so we're trying to move towards a more sustainable model financially and emotionally through herd management and land management. Now, what's great about a lot of strategies have so many co-benefits to the landfill, wildlife habitat, and to the ranch bottom line, without all the technical stuff. So we focus on the cattle, not the wolves. Focus on their ranch goals, not the conflict. And then leave it in that way. And it's really neat because it works. It's sustainable. And it does create, now it sounds idealistic, that win-win scenario. But it takes time initially. It takes a lot more of a higher skill level, I guess. It's not that simple just to do. And it takes initial resources. But for example, in California, you know, we really focused on this. And now you're trying to put in support there. They don't need us. And that's the idea. So those are, you know, so herd management is kind of the key focus of what we try to do, if the ranchers are ready and open to it.
Thank you. So this is a two-part question, so bear with me. John, with your background in Mexican gray wolf recovery at the California Wolf Center, would you explain the difference between Mexican gray wolves and gray wolves? Number one. Two, what type of wolves do you believe should be introduced in Colorado? Is the commission considering Mexican wolves, and why not? Or why?
All right, I will do my best. I do love the Lobos. So the Mexican gray wolf is a unique subspecies of gray wolf. I'm gonna back up here for a second, because you've been around wolf myth. I'm talking about the lies people tell. You're probably familiar with the Canadian wolf myth. This is the idea that, oh, they didn't reintroduce the right kind of wolf. They introduced this northern Canadian super predator. It's 200 pounds, they kill for fun, they're just mean and nasty. Totally bad for the environment. That's not true. Where there may be a shred of truth in that is that it was a different subspecies that was reintroduced in the northern Rockies because it was the subspecies that was available. Irremotus, the subspecies that used to live in Yellowstone, was gone. It's extinct. It's gone. So they brought the next best thing. And who do you think a subspecies distinction really matters to? It's primarily taxonomists and geneticists. There's very little behavioral difference between subspecies. That said, the Mexican gray wolf is a unique subspecies of gray wolf, historically found, of course, throughout Mexico and the southwest part of the United States, where it seems to be Mexico. This is a smaller subspecies, averaging between 50 and 90 pounds. Today, there are only, I believe, 196 left in the wild. That actually is the highest population we've had in 30, 40 years for the Mexican gray wolf. But the species has a lot of problems. They have a geographic restriction. They cannot go north of Interstate 40. If they do, they're captured and brought back. So they're not allowed to naturally expand. This is part of the way that that species is managed for their recovery. They've had a lot of roadblocks. Every Mexican wolf in the wild is about as closely related as the first cousin. So they need more genetics. These are reasons why I would love to see Mexican wolves in Colorado one day. However, we have a complicated history with this. If you've been following the commission meeting last week, you might be familiar with this point. In 2016, the Colorado Parks and Wildlife Commission opposed the intentional release of wolves into Colorado, including Mexican wolves, the belief being the Mexican wolf should be recovered in its historic range, with the argument being that Colorado was not part of its history. At that same time, then, Governor John Hickenlooper joined governors in New Mexico, Arizona, and Utah, and wrote what we colloquially call the Four Corners Letter, basically saying the same things. We don't want Mexican wolves in Colorado. Because of that, and a number of other reasons I won't get too deep into, I think it's very unlikely that that will be the subspecies of wolf reintroduced into Colorado, but I am hopeful that, and eventually see that northern Interstate 40 boundary removed, and that we can allow Mexican wolves to naturally come to Colorado if they like. I would certainly say, quick note on historic range, the world changes every day. Obviously, we're in a Holocene extinction. We are in a climate change crisis. And what used to be suitable habitat may no longer be suitable habitat. And habitat that wasn't suitable may be becoming suitable. So I think if wolves want to come to Colorado, if Mexican wolves want to come up north, we ought to allow them. But there are a bit of bureaucracy, I think. Thank you.
Great. So, can either or both of you speak on hunting concerns? So one concern is that wolves will, you know, kill all the ungulates and hunters won't be able to get their prey. So can you speak to hunting concerns and solutions and facts around this?
This might be a short because I really focus on the cattle, you know, focus side, not on the hunt side. But, you know, it's interesting because, you know, when wolves were introduced into Yellowstone, you know, there was a fairly dramatic, you know, population was blamed on the wolves. But there's so many other, you know, factors that are involved in that, like climate and other things. But one of the, you know, when people talk about, oh, wolves are going to control the elk populations and it's going to make hunting more difficult, it's not that they really control the populations, it's that they move the ungulates around the landscape and they make hunt access sometimes more challenging. So there may have been, you know, sometimes they say, oh, unit A is really low on elk, but unit this, you know, has got much more. Well, it may have moved again. Climate affects that, weather affects that, diseases affects that, and wolves affect that. That's their job, is to keep the ungulates, you know, elk here moving around the landscape, and that's what keeps things in a healthier state. So a lot of times it's hunter access, more than it is, you know, the drop of population. Of course, we know now that if you look at Idaho, Wyoming, Canada, there are higher numbers of elk now than for the reintroduction, and they're going into second shoulder season, having to extend this and that tag, and you know, look for the wolf population. So it's possible when wolves come in that we can see an initial, you know, kind of shock to the system. It's normal, but it's gonna over time, you know, predators go up, prey goes down, vice versa. You know, nature knows what it's doing. Obviously, wolves took out all the elk that they would have never been.
Yeah, Karin largely said it, but yeah, I mean, if you were to accept this argument that the wolves are going to decimate the elk population, once they get through the elk, they'll go through the deer, once they get through the deer, they'll come after your kids. And if you accept that argument, it's hard to imagine how anybody arrived in this country and found animals. You know, the elk and the wolves have been coexisting on this landscape for hundreds of thousands of years. We're the new kids on the block. I think we got a better idea on how to do things. But just like Karin said, all this information is right out there on the state game page. Idaho Fish and Game, Montana Fish, Wildlife and Parks, or Wyoming Fish and Game. Idaho's calling it the second golden age of elk hunting. Montana called it the decade of the elk. Elk populations are higher in all three northern Rocky Mountain states than they were when wolves were reintroduced. So we got 25 years of data, but we're still hearing the same myth we heard 25 years ago before we had the data. Now the data's solid. You'll hear two exceptions, the low-low zone, the northern Yellowstone elk herd. I'll quickly hit these. Low-low zone, massive fires about 100 years ago, created a lot of great food for elk. The elk had a heyday. But eventually the forest regrew, and it grew back into mature growth. And the elk said, oh, nothing here for me anymore, I'm on my way out. The elk population in the low-low zone was declining before the wolves were reintroduced, and the rate of their decline remained consistent. In the case of the northern Yellowstone elk herd, people love to show you this graph that starts in 1994. They don't like to show you 30 years before that. But that date is out there. In Yellowstone, we weren't allowing hunting. We got rid of all the wolves, and pretty much all the bears and cougars, and kind of got rid of all the predators, anything with claws and fangs. We kept the hooves and horns, and we stopped hunting them until their population was at an unsustainable high. And so the superintendent of the park said, well, you know what? If we do this wolf reintroduction, I think that might actually help. Combine that with some human hunting, I think we might be able to get this herd under control. And that's what happened. But if you don't have that context, you just look at a graph, you just see this precipitous decline and say, oh, yep, that's the wolves. They're the reason for it. But yeah, simply said, populations are up in all three states. Ecosystems are complicated. So I can't give you a guarantee of how things are going to go. But if the Northern Rockies are any evidence, I think our game bird would be just fine.
Great. Thanks so much. Chum, keep that microphone. Tell us about how many wolves will be reintroduced in Colorado.
Oh yes, this is a popular question. Nobody knows. Despite what somebody might call, I've got a buddy who's a game warden, whose cousin said, nobody knows. It has not been determined. This is something that will be determined in that draft management plan. But if I were to take a guess, between 1995 and 1996, 31 wolves were released in the Yellowstone National Park. That was it. It was 15 wolves, 16 wolves. That's all it took, because after 2 years, they realized, okay, these wolves are breeding, they're pairing off, they've got a population going, we don't need to add any. So I would be floored. I would be completely gobsmacked if we saw some massive influx of wolves being brought into Colorado like people fear. First of all, imagine the logistics of that. It's just a nightmare. Realistically, we're probably going to see 10 to 20 wolves released a year. We feel that they've got it from there.
We have more questions here, folks, but I do want to open it up for audience questions. So if you have a question you want to ask, raise your hand. I can run over to you and you can ask it, or if you want to write it down and give it to me, I'll ask it for you. But yeah, let's just start right here.
Do you think the wolves that in Colorado live, moving, will you keep them penned for a while, or will you just release them? I know there were two different ways of.
Yeah, so to reiterate, yeah, a hard release versus a soft release question. And to tell you what that is, a hard release means you take the wolves, say, from, you know, Idaho, we bring them down, and we just open the gate. That's a hard release. Off they go. A soft release would mean we create a temporary enclosure, and we kind of habituate the animal to that location. The idea being, when we open those gates, they'll stick around in that general area. So soft releases were tried in Yellowstone. Hard releases were tried in central Idaho, the Northern Rockies reintroduction. Both were successful. In the state of Colorado, where the conversation is right now is to do a hard release. The argument, as I understand it, is mostly a resource one again, that there's not a considerable degree of difference between the result of a harness off release, that they don't feel it's worth the extra investment. Certainly the fear in 1995 was that those wolves are going to go right back home to Canada. You know, if we release them, and our release, they're going to turn around and go home. For that reason, they say the average distance you might see a wolf travel post-release is about 30 miles. So the recommendation, as I've been hearing it, is that no reintroduction will happen 50 miles of a state border, which eliminates a lot of Colorado. Okay. If you're thinking western slope and then carve 50 miles from New Mexico, Utah, and Wyoming, and not a lot of options left, but that's likely where we will see the release.
Great. I'm going to ask one question and then go back to the audience, but I think that this one's kind of important, and this goes to you, Karin. What would a chronic depredation, and please explain what depredation means, of cattle lead to at this current moment in the Colorado Parks and Wildlife planning process?
That is a good question. So first of all, when we talk about depredation, what we mean is cattle, sheep, any sort of livestock being taken by a wolf. Doesn't necessarily mean it was killed by a wolf, but you're included as well. But I think it's really important to understand hear about chronic depredation that work a lot. And there's always discussion of how many cows have to be taken for that to warrant that this is a chronic situation. The only way to turn this around is by control. And that's where it gets tricky. And I know I've been in conversations and we're trying to create a little bit more awareness within the agency folks working on this, that you can't look at it that way. Because just because one rancher is getting hit repeatedly by wolves doesn't mean it's chronic. Doesn't mean that those wolves have habituated or are targeting cattle. It could mean, and most likely means early on in a situation that we're experiencing now, a vulnerability issue. When wolves are traveling the landscape, they are constantly testing prey they come across, whether it's elk, deer, or cows. And they, as they test them, they are going to look for that critter that gives the highest success opportunity for a successful hunt and lowest risk to themselves. So if it happens to be a calf, a newborn calf, maybe the cow isn't, you know, really focused on protecting that calf, or like that one case in Colorado where the wolves were chasing the elk jumped into a cow pasture, spooked the cattle, they went into a draw with willow. The elk went in there, but the elk could get out, the cow couldn't. Vulnerability. So it's really important that when we look at this, it isn't just three strikes or this many. You know, the folks in charge need to look at the big picture and look at it. Is this something that can be turned around for this particular rancher in this situation? Or are these wolves targeting cattle? And there are scenarios where that happens. Sometimes they will learn that and then start seeking out cattle. That's where you can have a problem that's really hard to turn around, becomes chronic. But it's not just a numbers thing. So right now, what we're trying to do is turn this around before it does become chronic. Because so far, it's one landowner, thousands of cattle, and the wolves are passing through these cattle every week, no issues. Not chronic. Does that make sense?
Great, we'll move to this side. Any questions over here? Here you
go. So I've been following along Wisconsin's wolf story, and I'm kind of curious about thinking about reintroduction here, thinking about the 2021 wolf hunt, Wisconsin, 3 days, 300 wolves killed. How does that factor into the management plan? How are we thinking about like responsibility of bringing these animals into this place? And the possibility that outside hunting group could sue for the rights to hunt. If anyone hasn't looked that up, Wisconsin 2021, it's hard. So I'm curious, like, with that backdrop to this 2021 of February, how's that factoring into the reintroduction?
John, can
you
explain non-game species?
Yeah, I think that I appreciate it. With Wisconsin's the mess, if you haven't followed, they have a real issue with Predator Control Board, a particular member who refuses to leave because IRMPA, he's a very anti-wolf tool. We were very sensitive about this, though, here in Colorado, as we were talking about the reintroduction. Of course, you know, you look at other places and say, well, we've recovered the wolf in some of these states, but, you know, at what cost? We're having so many wolves killed through a recreational hunt, through illegal poaching, and through predator control actions. You know, so how do we kind of justify all this? Well, this is a recent, and this is somewhat salient point, might tie into our call to actions a little bit. We were very specific in the language of Proposition 114 to define the gray wolf as a non-game species. What that means is it is not a species eligible for a recreational hunt. Having said that, this is of course what, you know, hunting advocates want. You know, maybe not a lot, a lot of the sports persons groups want a recreational hunt, and they're really pushing us for, when's that gonna happen? How many wolves does it need to be? Just like we see with the North Province. So there is some discussion about the commission is considering, do they have the authority to change that definition? I would argue it needs to be changed by the legislature because of the passage of Prop 114, that's now statute. Statute trumps the policy of an appointed commission. So there is some debate about this though. And I anticipate this issue is going to be coming up. So it's something I think for all of us who maybe want to see a future in Colorado with a healthy wolf population, do not want to see recreational hunt. It's important that we make it clear that what we voted for, what we understood we were voting for, was a non-game species of gray wolf in Colorado. Colorado does not have the appetite for a predator hunt. We don't like it with bears, don't like it with cats, don't want it with wolves.
And that actually speaks kind of to the lethal part too, you know, as we talked about trying to reduce vulnerability to cattle, you know, so that they stick going after elk. You know, we talked about going to lethal, you know, when we're speaking with the ranching community, you know, there's this huge social divide, obviously. You know, a lot of times both advocates, urban, you know, versus rural, we hear that a lot. And just as we try to encourage folks that are, you know, wolf advocates to be cautious and mindful of the things that they say, you know. You start, you know, kind of bashing off ranchers, it's not really going to get them to want to work with us. But also when we talk to ranchers, you know, when they talk about, you know, gosh, we just need to kill lethal or lethal control. You know, what we try to do is get them to understand that's not going to help them stay on the landscape either, you know, when you're looking at that. And so it's just getting folks to understand what the outcome of all of these things are, hunting or lethal, does it really help us meet the end goal for each of our causes of what we're focused on? And killing goals is not going to help ranchers. Us, you know, targeting ranchers and saying getting off the land doesn't help wolves. So it's kind of being mindful of beyond that immediate, what are the long-term outcomes and how's it going to affect all of our goals and all of us?
Thank you. Dillon, Hanson-Ahumada. Over there.
Any questions over here?
So I would consider myself a very small baby horses, and I'm pro. I grew up in Minnesota, and we've always had the gray wolf, and I grew up living with the wolf, so I'm very pro wolf. But I'm also very pro baby horse. So as I hear you guys talking about all of this, what I hear what's missing for the public is, well, how do we prepare ourselves for this? Because I understand my heart, my head, that this needs to happen, but I also need to protect my livestock. And for me, what I'm thinking is bring them in at night, and maybe I have to invest Pyrenees dogs, something to protect Dobermans or something to protect the border. Now, I'm small, I'm 5 acres, but what I have, I love very much. So, and that's probably what most people have, because the big ranchers have enough cattle and they're insured and they can lose a calf here and there. And it's an industry, it's a hamburger. It's not something that you like love dearly, like how we love our horses do, right? So what I'm trying to understand is, all right, okay, I'm pro wolf, but how do I prepare myself?
That is actually a really good point. And there are ways to do so. And it's interesting because obviously I'm very pro wolf, but I've also learned to love the ranch community, see them, you know, successful. And what I've learned in working with those ranchers, whether they have, you know, the small 5 acres or 1,000 acres, is how much they really do care for those cows, those breeding cows. I mean, they have names for them, you know, and they take it very, very, very seriously. They lose one, it's more of an emotional toll than an economic toll. I can't tell you how many times I've seen, Christ, not the loss of money, it's the loss of that animal, because while those animals are in their care so deep. But yes, seeing that, you know, because I'm working with a couple small, really small ranches, and they're worried because they've got their turkeys and goats and their horses. And, you know, and those are a little bit, actually, in some ways, easier because you can't tie penning, hot wire, there's different tools like I've talked about. And of course, there's folks that are more than happy to get into more details, you know. Feel free to reach out to myself or John, and, you know, get a better feel for your operation. There's no two scenarios are the same, right? They should appreciate different circumstances and kind of see what the risks are. But yeah, I worry for, you know, where I live, guys come in, the mountain lions come in, and had a couple of close calls with their dogs, you know? So I can understand that. And that's something that you have to be sensitive to, whether it's a small operation like yours or the big ranching operations too. Because those losses of emotional have more control than cannot. They know they can get compensated. It's for a lot of ranchers, it's not the point, even though that's what we think about. Dillon?
One more, then we're gonna wrap it up. Okay, this question is directed to Karin. And I'm gonna name names. Don Hiddles, he's a rancher. He's a poster child for the anti-wolf ranchers. He says he's lost 3 calves, and over the past few years, he's lost more animals than calves in 60 years. I understand that he's had volunteers up there to help patrol at night the wolves. He's been up there 2 a.m. patrolling that he lost anyway. Colorado Parks and Rec, they're trying, I'll be blunt, they're trying to make sure this is not pets, that the wolves are not reintroduced in 2023. They're even proposing an amendment, you know, to change everything so that it's postponed or canceled. And I don't know what my question is, you know, but I'm just very concerned because Don Gittleson is on the news just about every other day. And he's getting a lot of sympathy, which is fine, but that's not helping the cause.
I hear what you're saying, and I kind of want to answer this too, and I'm going to pass it along to this too. But I think that that's where the public narrative campaign comes in, right? Because all you see in the news is the bad news. Right, good news doesn't often make it into the headlines. But what Karin and John and those on the ground are doing should be making it into the headlines, and I'll pass it off to Karin. But I think that that's where we really need to start being active, and this is a really wonderful time to be a Colorado wolf activist, and something that we probably won't see again in our lifetime, right? So that's a call to action, but I'm gonna give it to Karin so she can answer this question.
So I can't go into too much detail with Don Gittleson due to confidentiality, right? A family with a very small operation. And, you know, we work very closely with him. What I will say, and I agree, I get frustrated with media, so I think I brought it up right off the bat. and even sometimes, and Don and I have talked about it, but it's a very emotionally charged thing. What I can tell you, what people don't see, is this family is got to my heart. They're good people. He worked so hard. He has tried everything that we've put in front of him.
And there was some resistance with some of the, you know, pieces, but we moved beyond that because of the relationships that we built. And we will continue to support him. He is right in the pathway of those critters. You know, there was a certain things that kind of led up to what happened. And he probably will have more conflict, and he probably will be upset again. But I know how it comes across in the media, but I can tell you, he has actually really helped us with the wolf thing there. He's not his animal. Let's just put it. And that's the thing, you gotta get to know these people. It's different to see them when they're worked up, you know, the news. Certain, like even that last article that came out, it's like, really, that's the votes they took? That's what happened. But there's so much, when you're sitting down face to face with people, coexistence is real, it's raw, it's not easy, it's emotional, it's a roller coaster ride, but it's about the people. And I think it's really important that before we judge them, it's about sit in front of them and have a conversation.
Great. I'm going to end us with one question for the panelists here, but I know some of y'all have more questions, and I've written them down, so when we're done, feel free to come up and give those to me or ask questions of us. I'm sure some of us would be happy to answer those, but I do have one more question before Rosie gives us our calls to action. So last question for both y'all is, why Colorado? Why reintroduce wolves? Why now? And what are the values that have led us here?
All right, why Colorado? Well, here's the biggest reason why Colorado is the missing link. We have wolf populations in the northern Rockies. We have the Mexican wolf population just south of us. Historically, Colorado was a state of integration genetically for the different subspecies of gray wolf. So, you know, when you say why Colorado, to me, it's so we can restore that north-south corridor so that we can have genetic exchange, which is now so necessary for the Mexican wolf. I don't know how bad their genetics are. We need that north-south exchange of free roaming wolves going where they want to go within reasonable limitations. and existing as their biology dictates that they should exist. There was some more technical part that I've already missed. Philosophy. But the values. I think part of what's always made wolves so complicated for us, I think, is how much we sometimes see ourselves in them. They have families, they have nuclear families, that, you know, it's the mom and dad, kids, and that loyalty and that camaraderie together. They're one of very few species that will actually nurture the sick and injured, provided there's enough resources. And I think on one hand, that's allowed us to create dogs, and on the other hand, it's allowed us to create the big bad wolf and to create this demonization of wilderness, really. But I think something that all people in Colorado agree with is that we love the natural resources of this state. I mean, honestly, we're so blessed to live in the American West, so much land has been preserved as public land. That's not a benefit on the East Coast. Public land is really hard to find. And so out here, we want to cherish that, we want to celebrate that. We talk about doing a wolf reintroduction. We are talking about 17 million acres of public land on the western slope. And while people might rightfully say, well, it's largely the Front Range that voted for this, that's our land too. Geographically adjacent to public lands doesn't give you any more ownership of it than I do living in Lakewood. So when we look at values, I think one of Colorado's values is restoring the natural balance. We do want a healthy, wild ecosystem that we can pass on to future generations. And that's really what the wolf restoration was at it core.
Thank you for Colorado, as John said. I just think that we have an incredible opportunity here to actually get it. We have an opportunity to finally create, after all these years, that lasting wildfire for wolves, livestock, to successfully share the land. Right. We can do it right. But it's going to be up to the people and our mindsets. It's not a cow fox, not a wolfish deer. Again, I keep bringing up people. I mean, I got into this because I love wolves and realized, wow, this is where it's at. And that's what it's going to take. But we can create a new paradigm here. And I think if we can do this here, it will reflect that. The state's still struggling because all eyes are on Colorado. And if it goes well here, you know, that is going to be significant for wolves across the West. If it doesn't, they have it, we take it. But it really is up to everybody here, you know, work with the ranchers. They recognize that. I can tell you that most of them, you know, that we're working with right now are just really on board to try to fix out. They recognize the landscape's not the same as it was, you know, 10 years ago. Not the bulls, not the livestock. And, you know, they care deeply, and I think together, we can just put down the barriers here a little bit, spend more time, have conversations. We can make this work. Bulls can thrive. Yeah, it can be the example of the other states. So for me, that's why I'm so hardcore focused on the state, even though we're working in multiple states.
You can keep that. All right, a quick round of applause for our panelists. Thank you both. This is not the last time that I will be asking anything from you. So there's a flyer with a whole host of QR codes that you can pick up at some of our tables in the back. And we're going to ask you to take some action. So there's a couple things that you can do to let your voice be heard, because once again, this is a great time to be a wolf activist in Colorado. So first, we need your voices at the Stakeholder Advisory Group on June 22nd and 23rd. Right. Me and Dillon will be kind of hosting a small get-together in preparation for comments to give to the Stakeholder Advisory Group, because it is, these are our public lands. We want wolves to be here, and we want to be successful at this reintroduction effort. And it's going to take all of us. So please find that QR code on our tables in the back. For one opportunity. And then we also need your voices at the Colorado Parks and Wildlife Commission meeting to give some comments on wolves. The sign-up has not been released on the website yet, but you can actually submit public comments through the Keystone website. Sorry, I keep cutting in and out. Once again, these are all on that call to action page that you can find at the back. And then a plug for my own organization, WildEarth Guardians. We are doing a webinar on June 14th, next Tuesday, about what has happened since Proposition 114, which will highlight John Murtaugh as well, and some staff of WildEarth Guardians, once again on the QR codes on the call to action. Again, thank you all so much for coming out. This is great. Thank you, DJ Mantra, for the amazing work. And thank you again to Endangered Species Coalition and Rocky Mountain Wild, as well as WildEarth Guardians.